and welcome to IHW Council's special web series on Rh negative incompatibility. I'm Anisha Nair Dhawan, and you're watching our exclusive show on Rh negative blood group and its impact on pregnancy. A healthy pregnancy is a celebration for the entire family to welcome a new member. But there are a few things that would-be parents should be aware of when starting a family. One of these issues is Rh incompatibility. This occurs when a pregnant woman whose blood type is Rh negative, for example, B negative, is exposed to the Rh positive blood from her fetus, say, for example, B positive. Because of this incompatibility, the mother develops Rh antibodies, which have the potential to cross the placenta and attach or destroy the fetus's red blood cells. This causes the fetus to become anemic. In severe cases, the baby may need special blood transfusions called exchange transfusions either before birth, which is the intrauterine fetal transfusion, or after delivery. Some fetuses may also have jaundice and anemia because of this condition. Now, on our show today, this is a special one as we're going to talk about Rh negative blood group and its impact on pregnancy. And to guide you for this and answer all your questions on this, we have Dr. Nidhi Gupta, Professor, Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, SN Medical College, Agra. Welcome to our show, Dr. Nidhi.
Thank you so much, Anisha, for the kind introduction. Thank you so much.
Now, before I begin the conversation, I would like to reach out to all our viewers who are tuning in and watching us. Keep sending us your questions in the comment box, and we'll try to get all of those answered by our expert over the next 30 minutes. Do like and comment with your feedback on our page and share the special show on your wall if you find that your friends and family may also get benefited from it. So let's begin, Dr. Gupta. I'm trying to explain what the situation is in my words, but for the benefit of everyone tuning in, what really is this Rh incompatibility?
We have to understand that every human has a blood group. There is an ABO group and there is the rhesus group. It was Landsteiner and Steen in 1939. They found out that there was, because we are descendants of the rhesus monkey, they found out that there were some blood groups which were present in humans, and there was some blood groups which were not present. And because of, even if there was no ABO incompatibility, compatibility between the bloods which were transfused, some people developed blood transfusion reactions. So it was found out that if 100 people from the world were taken into account, 85 of them had this antigen, which is called the rhesus antigen, which was present in the chromosome 1, and around 15% of the worldwide people did not have this antigen, so it was absent in them. So all those who had the antigen were Rh positive, and all those who did not have the antigen was Rh negative. So one important factor was that one, when now blood transfusions were given, they were safer because we were not only detecting the ABO groups, we were also detecting the rhesus group, that the Rh group.
Okay.
Secondly, it was seen that there were some fetuses which were abnormal, which were born in 1939, they found out there were these swollen babies which were coming out from women, which were swollen, which were anemic, which were hyperbilirubinemic, and they used to die immediately after death. They named them erythroblastosis or hydrofetalis babies, and they found out in 1940, they linked this disease with an Rh negative mother. That is, if an Rh negative mother marries an Rh positive person and has a baby from an Rh positive husband, then there is 50 to 100% chances that the baby will be Rh positive. Because this Rh positive antigen is not present in the Rh negative mother, the blood and the whole system of the Rh negative woman takes it as foreign and makes antibodies against it. And this is called as alloimmunization. And these antibodies in the first pregnancy, what happens is that it takes almost 3 to 4 months for these antibodies to form. And they are, it takes a longer time. They are very, there is a weak antibody response, and we have the IgM antibodies, which do not cross the placenta. So the first pregnancy can go, just forego without any effect on the baby. But what happens subsequently, that when the woman conceives again for the second or the third time, the immune system has these ready antibodies present. And once she conceives again, these immunoglobulins, they cross the placenta and cause the hemolytic disease of the newborn. This is the gist of the story as it is. And if you would like to, this rhesus antigen is very, very rare in the Chinese and the Japanese population, and very, very high in the Spanish and the Caucasian. And because of a lot of mixed cross marriages and misbreeding and other things, India was actually at a 4% rate. And now we are seeing that Rh negative pregnancies are high to the tune of 8-10%. So the need for all of us to be aware to save the baby from perinatal mortality and morbidity.
Right. So, ma'am, the way you've explained it, you said that a small percentage of the general population has the Rh negative rhesus factor. And during blood transfusion, we are safe because we investigate beforehand, you know, what kind of blood we're getting. But how does the child get impacted? Because, you know, the mother's blood is running through her veins and the child is safely inside the placenta. So how do these antibodies cross over and then attack the little baby's red blood cells?
A very nice point, Anisha, because we have to understand that there is a, you know, people think, they say that the mother has given the blood to the child. It is actually not scientifically correct. Normally what happens that the yolk sac, even as early as 36 days, starts forming RBCs. And then the hematopoiesis of the baby occurs in the liver. Mother makes her own blood. The fetus makes his or her own blood. And there is no mixing of blood. Only what happens, the placenta forms and the villi, the maternal villi and the fetal villi just come and cross each other like this. So there is no mixing actually. There is only passage. There is a small lining which passes the nutrients and the oxygen from the mother maternal side to the fetus, and all the excreta goes to the mother. What happens is that whenever there is this break in this placental barrier, because of any reason, antepartum hemorrhage, any abruption, or at the time of delivery, when there is a little break in this, there is something known as the fetal-maternal hemorrhage. That is the fetal RBCs come into the maternal circulation. Whenever this occurs, then if it is the first pregnancy, presence of these fetal RBCs with this foreign antigen for that mother, because the mother is Rh negative. For her, these fetal RBCs carrying the rhesus antigen are foreign. So her body makes antibodies. In the first pregnancy, these antibodies are IgM antibodies, which are weak antibodies, and they are bigger antibodies which do not cross the placenta, but the mother becomes sensitized. So usually the first child will not be affected by the hemolytic disease of newborn.
So what you're saying, when the mother is sensitized, it means that during the first pregnancy, if these antibodies are formed, should the mother on a subsequent occasion have a Rh positive blood somewhere in her body, then the antibodies will react and attack it as foreign object.
No, I don't. The mother should never be given Rh positive.
No. If the fetus's blood comes in contact with the mother, so now the body recognizes because of the previous episode.
So it recognizes it and makes antibodies. And what happens is once the antibodies are made, the antigen antibody reaction occurs and these RBCs are killed. They are live. They break down. Because of the breaking down of these RBCs, there is fetal anemia and there is hyperbilirubinemia. So I just want to say that in the first pregnancy, the the mother is sensitized and she makes antibodies. These are like, you know, the BSF soldiers who kill the infiltration of foreigners. It is just like that. This is a random attack to that mother. And next time when the attack, the BSF is well prepared and the antibodies are in, there is an amnestic reaction, there is a very quick response, there is a lot of antibodies, and these antibodies cross the placental barrier, go to the fetus and kill the fetal RBC.
So
that's why it will cause problems in the fetus.
Ma'am, how often is this seen in the Indian perspective? And I mean, would be parents aware about this at all?
The awareness is very, very poor. And I think it is very, very important that I feel that in the adolescent education programs, where you are giving tetanus toxoid to the young adolescent girls before marriage, a blood grouping, which is such a simple test, should be done. So it's important that when you do the, horoscope matching of the partners, it should be the blood group matching, which is more important now. But a lot of things have changed over the world, a lot of changes have come, and we are able to save a lot of babies. And now the immunization, the isoimmunization, alloimmunization rates have gone down by prevention and with anti-D immunization to almost to the tune of 0.1%, which were very, very high earlier.
So you're saying that even if there is RH incompatibility between the partners, say a man and a woman, that shouldn't be a reason for them to not start a family or not get married, because there are treatments available.
It is important that they go for preconceptional counseling before that. If they are, if the mother is RH negative, the whole problem starts with the mother. See, there are a lot of things like, it's because this is a public awareness program. If the father is homozygous with the D antigen, then all the progeny, all the kids he produces will be positive. If he's heterozygous, then 50% of the kids may be just RH negative. So if the mother, an RH negative mother, carries a RH positive baby, then there is problem for that baby.
Right. I mean, I started getting a few questions from those watching the show. And one Facebook user is asking, does this occur only after hemorrhage, or every negative mother will develop the antibody?
Very nice question. Usually it occurs, there are minute hemorrhages which keep occurring all the time. And as the gestation advances, these hemorrhages go on increasing. Normally the amount of hemorrhage, if there is not a major hemorrhage, it is less than 3 ml. But these minute hemorrhages are always there. So the mother gets sensitized to the and makes the antibodies. So that's why there is this prevention program where all women who are RH negative, whether they are alloimmunized, whether they are Coombs test positive or not, should be given an anti-D at 28 weeks. And the maximum fetal-maternal hemorrhage takes place at the time of delivery, which is very important.
Right. So it is a risk factor even before the delivery happens, right?
Yeah, true.
Right. Another question coming in is, can RH-positive parents have RH-negative baby?
See, that depends on, again, the zygosity of the parents. If both the parents are heterozygous, that means they have a dominant D and a recessive D, right? There are two genes. There are two genes, a dominant gene and a recessive D. If they're heterozygous with a dominant gene and a recessive gene, both parents, then they can have a RH. What was your question, sorry?
And the question is
RH positive.
Yeah, both parents are RH positive. Can the baby be RH negative?
Yeah, they can have. But both parents RH negative cannot have a RH positive baby.
Okay.
You have to blame the neighbor. You have to blame somebody else. Okay.
Okay. Ma'am, the other very important question coming in is, how is RH incompatibility treated? I mean, what happens to parents who whose child will have
there
this
are two
incompatibility?
Aspects of treatment. One is prevention, because we know now that fetal-maternal hemorrhage keeps occurring. So it is important that if there is a woman who is RH negative, she should come, she should get, at the first booking, she should get her blood grouping done. If it is negative, we test her husband, and if he is positive, then it is a surety that 50% to 100% the progeny, the baby, is positive. So we start treating her. From 20 weeks onwards, we do an indirect Coombs test, which tells us whether this woman or this baby is at risk or not. So otherwise, it is said that every 4 weeks, that is 20, 24, 28 weeks, it should be done. But those who can afford can be done repeatedly. But if those who cannot afford, then we call the woman at 28 weeks, indirect Coombs test. If it is negative, then we give her a 300 micrograms of anti-D injection, which will take care of any fetal-maternal hemorrhage which has already occurred, and also the fetal-maternal hemorrhage which has occurred at the time of delivery. And the second thing is that we give another anti-D 3000 micrograms of injection within 72 hours of the delivery of the baby, so that if in case she wants to become pregnant again, that this will cater to all the fetal-maternal hemorrhages which have taken place at the time of delivery.
All right. So there is proper treatment and a proper plan, but you should be counseled and
these
you should
are for
know.
Women, yeah. This is for women who are not immunized. Those all women right. who have become alloimmunized, that means they have antibodies, can undergo treatment also. Now, suppose a woman comes with an indirect Coombs test positive, we do the titers. The critical titers are between 1 to 8 to 1 to 32, depending on the lab reporting. But we have taken a middle one, that is 1 to 16 is taken the critical titer, where we know that if the antibodies are at this level, then the baby is definitely going to get affected.
Okay.
So if the critical titers are high, these women are under the high risk category and under the doctor's close observation. A few years back, Anisha, we were having, you know, this area was actually in the gray zone, and we used to do amniocentesis of the women, and we used to do spectrophotometry at 450 nanograms and see, you know. And there were fantastic Lily charts, because what happened, this child, because of the antibody, the blood used to get destroyed, the bilirubin used to leak into the amniotic fluid, and this bilirubin was detected. But these were invasive tests. Now we have come up with a very special test, which is the color Doppler of the middle cerebral artery of the brain, which we come to know the peak systolic velocity. It is a non-invasive test with the woman can come. And if this peak velocity is more than 1.5 medians of multiples, then this woman is at a greater risk of the baby having a lot of problems. And then nowadays, the latest technology is intrauterine transfusion, which we give to this baby.
All right. Ma'am, another question coming in is, are there any benefits of being RH negative? Is there any benefit of your RH at all? It looks like it's negative, but it's just what it is, right?
The benefit of RH negative is, number one, there was a time when at the time of war, you know, and because there was something known as O negative blood, which was like a universal donor, which you could give to any person. So, importance of RH negative being is because it's a rare kind of a blood. You can help a woman with a RH negative. Then O negative blood is like a universal donor, which can you can give. And even these babies who are given transfusion are actually given, you know, O negative blood as a universal donor after they are cross-matched with the maternal blood. So I think that is one of the importance of this being an
RH negative. Another question coming in is, does being Rh negative cause miscarriage?
See, actually, there is a lot of controversy on this because first time the mother will carry the baby safely. Second, and consequently, what happens, it will depend on the titers of antibody which she has. Okay, if the antibody titer present is very, very high, this antibody IgG will cross the placenta and may cause abortions. But it would need a lot of RCTs to prove this, because actually the system, the blood supply, everything starts, the RBC, fetal RBC start forming after 35 days. So some people believe that early abortions could be because of this, and some believe that no, Rh will affect the baby and will not cause miscarriages. So the exact consensus for this is not there. But for all practical purposes, for the public awareness, I would say that Rh negativity will cause miscarriages in case it is not treated.
All right. So it is an important factor that everybody must keep in mind. And we've got more questions coming in, and I'd like to club two of these questions coming in from a Facebook user. He's asking, RHC negative is also, is RHC negative, RHD negative is, what is the difference between RH negative C and D types?
Very fantastic question. I think this is the doctor asking me. Actually, we have to understand that on chromosome 1, we have chromosome 1 is actually the for the rhesus factor. Okay. So we have five antigens there. It is capital D, capital C, small c, capital E, and E. These are the five antigens which are present on this chromosome one. And because there was a time when they were talking of C and E, but actually because D is a very dominant factor, and this is the factor which causes most of the problems, so we do not address C and E a lot, because we because as it is a 8 to 10% population being Rh negative, and that also D being very dominant, so we do not cater to the C and E antigens which are present in the chromosome. We are just catering to the D because that is a difficult antigen which is causing a lot of dangerous things to the fetus. So there is a C antigen, there is a E antigen, very rightly said. But we do not cater to those abnormalities or incompatibilities now.
All right. So, ma'am, you said that there is treatment to be given to a prospective mother if she has developed the antibodies beforehand, and also during her pregnancy, she can be given the treatment. But the main important thing is that you should be aware so that you can alert your doctor as well, right?
Yeah.
Ma'am, the treatments that you have mentioned, how long does it take? I mean, this is, you know, before, you know, the woman has developed antibodies, but before the child, she has conceived, what, how long is the treatment then?
See, the treatment is, if she is affected, if the titers are high, and I told you that you have to do the color Doppler of the brain of the baby, and if that peak systolic velocity is more than 1.5 multiples of median, that means that the baby is affected. Then we do a podocentesis, that is intrauterine. Under the ultrasound scan, we take out the blood of the fetus with the baby inside the womb. And we do the hematocrit. Hematocrit is the amount of blood, hemoglobin, and the other RBCs present. If this hematocrit is more than 30, we just keep this woman under observation doing the MCA-PCV, which is a non-invasive test. If this hematocrit is less than 30, then we do an intrauterine transfusion of blood for this baby. Because if we do not take care of this baby will develop a hydroxyphetalis condition, wherein the baby will have severe fetal anemia, because the RBCs are breaking because of the antibodies. The blood will, the heme will come out, her bilirubin, the baby's bilirubin level will increase, and if it is more than 20, deposited in the fetal brain and causes colitis. And third, then there is a problem called, because of a decrease in the hematocrit, there is third space, there is a lot of fluid collection in the abdominal cavity, in the pleural cavity, in the pericardial cavity, and the baby is, you know, a swollen Buddha type of a baby, which is called hydrops fetalis. And these babies may even die inside the uterus or may even be fresh stillbirths. So we have to save the baby, and saving the baby, we have come out with the fetal therapy, that is intrauterine blood transfusion for these babies.
Right. Ma'am, say the titias are not very high and the mother carries the baby till term. So when the baby is born, does the baby need treatment then? Will the baby be fine? Will he have jaundice or anemia? And can these be treated at birth?
Yeah, they can be treated postnatally also. And see, there are three type of fetuses, mild, moderate, and severe. There are a few fetuses who will just have a mild anemia, a little bilirubin, high bilirubin levels, and that will be taken care of if the titers are not high. Second variety is a moderate kind of disease in the neonate, where there will be severe anemia, there will be hyperbilirubinemia, where the baby will need phototherapy and will need blood transfusions and will be fine. The severe variety, we have to prevent a hydrops and we have to treat the severe variety. That is important, because once the hydrops develops, it is very difficult for us to see such baby. So that is important.
And so then these severe cases have to be treated in the intrauterine fashion, and you cannot wait till the time of the delivery.
No, they have to be treated later too, but most important is that they are treated in the intrauterine life by fetal therapy.
All right. And ma'am, now even in the medical community, is there sufficient awareness plus the existence of these high-end equipment to do this kind of testing, which you said was now non-invasive?
See, these testings are not available everywhere. There's fetal therapy. There are special fetal medicine doctors who are trained to do this. So everywhere, this is not available. And in places like me, I'm in a government medical college where we do not have fetal medicine people, and we are not doing intrauterine transfusions. For there, what we do is, once the baby is out, we do an exchange transfusion. Okay. That is, we take out the affected blood. That is, 15 ml of that blood is taken out and 10 ml of the Rh negative blood is injected to the baby. So we are doing exchange transfusions to save these babies also, which we've been doing for quite a few times. Fetal therapy has come out in a decade or so.
All right. Dr. Nidhi, thank you so much for joining us today and helping us with all the questions that you've answered. And you've raised so much awareness, so many new things I myself have learned. I'm a mother of two kids. I never knew that this would be such an important issue. But thank you so much for creating awareness about this important issue. When you are welcoming a new member in your family, all steps you should take to ensure that this is a happy occasion. And you can do this by being aware. Thank you so much for joining us today and answering all the questions that you've taken up today. And thank you for creating awareness about this critical issue in our country. Now, if you're watching this show and if you have any more questions, keep sending them to us through WhatsApp. You can even click on our WhatsApp button on the page and send us your questions. Don't forget to follow us and stay updated on all the concerns about your health and well-being. We will be back again taking up more questions from your side on this issue again next week on Wednesday. Send us your questions and join us again. And, do keep a track of the iStartu page to be updated on all the latest that we are doing. This program is supported by Bharat Serums and Vaccines Limited under its public awareness initiative. We'll be back again with a special show on Rh Negative Incompatibility next week. Same time, do follow us on Facebook and get all the updates on our family programs. And keep sending us the questions. We'll be happy to take them up in our next show. Till then, stay at home and take care. Goodbye.